What is up, guys? Welcome back today to another video on this channel. Hope you're all doing amazing and fantastic. Welcome to 10 Reasons Why, where I'm going to be breaking down 10 reasons so as to why I like a particular book or a series of books. In this particular video, we're going to be going over George's Secret Key to the Universe, written by Stephen and Lucy Hawking. Lucy Hawking is Stephen Hawking's daughter, and I assume you all know who Stephen Hawking is, one of the most brilliant minds of our century. So without any further ado, let's jump right into it. Before I start talking about what all I liked in this book, for those of you who have a very vague idea what this book is about, it's about a young kid called George who goes to his neighbor's house and finds out his neighbor is an internationally celebrated scientist, and he has a computer called Cosmos. Cosmos is able to zip them across the cosmos and is able to send them from one place to another by opening wormholes. Stephen Hawking's own theory described what wormholes are, though right now in the real world, according to me, as far as I know, wormholes are theoretically possible but have never been physically sighted. Like, black holes have been sighted and they are physically possible, theoretically possible. But so are wormholes, but not a single wormhole has been sighted till date. So now that's a little backstory to this book. It's about a young boy, a girl, and the girl's father who go around the cosmos, going through millions of galaxies and planets and stars, going on different adventures. This series spans over a total of 6 books, out of which I have read the 4 you can see right here. I'm hoping to complete the series very soon, and I want to talk about what I'm liking about it right now. To those of you who are reading at this point, we can read this together. So let's jump right into the video. Point number 1 is a relatable or not so relatable character. The protagonist of this story, George, is a really, really complex character. He's not a character who you can imagine to be a particular genre. So if I had to describe how he was, he's a kid who loves science. He likes to know about how the world works, how the planets work. He loves zipping through the cosmos, and he loves doing all those things with Eric and his best friend Annie. Eric is Annie's dad, of course. On the other hand, George is a complete eco-activist. He hates science, blames it for all of the problems on Earth, and he's totally against it, doesn't use it in his own house. So on one side, there's a part of George which immensely loves science. And on the other side, there's a part of George that hates it. The reason for the hating side is simply because his parents are hardcore eco-activists. They prefer to exclude everything technological from their lives. The only thing they do have is a phone. They even generate their own electricity by having their own windmills. So they live a life which is completely devoid of all the technological marvels we have today. You're probably watching this on a device which they didn't have, and I'm probably recording this on a device which they didn't have. Everything around me, like lighting and the video, the camera that I'm using to record this video, the microphone, those type of things, they won't have. So they live a very, very, very solitary life. Now, on the other side of George's personality is a kid who wants to grow up and be a scientist. A kid who wants to explore the entire universe. A kid who wants to learn about everything there is to learn. So that character development is something I've seen very, very, very less in many different books. And I have read so many books, the character development is really good in many of them. But here it's just 2 split personalities of one person growing at the same time. One does not overpower the other. In my opinion, he is just about equally an eco-activist as he is a scientist. He prefers to try to keep his science as non-harmful as it can, and as the book teaches you, not all science is harmful. Only the people who want it to be harmful or use it for wrong things, that's what makes science deteriorate the world. So he really hates science, but on the other hand, he turns into a George who can immediately flip his side and completely hate it. So I love that part of the book, the fact that the main protagonist himself is such a complex character. Point number 2, a heartwarming story. Apart from the thoughts and notes that Stephen Hawking himself has penned down in this book, his daughter Lucy Hawking has done a marvelous job of writing a perfect storyline to go along with it. I would not say that this book is factual in any shape, way, or form, because this book has a powerful storyline going along with it. It shows you all the things about valor, bravery, courage, and most importantly, friendship when it comes to doing things together. overall, all throughout all the books I've read, these values progress exponentially and they keep increasing with every book until I feel they'll be bonded for the rest of their lives. So all of these different values of bravery and friendship are spun into a web of amazing storylines. Point number three is a really difficult one to understand. It is Schrödinger's cat. I hope I'm pronouncing that correct. Now, Schrödinger's cat is in a particular book, but the reason I like that particular book was not because it focused on Schrödinger's cat, just because it brought my attention to this thing. Now, it'll be extremely hard to follow the following things, so I have dropped lots of informative links in the description down below. All of the sources are in the description down below. You can go down, check it out, and see everything I'm trying to explain to you right now. So bear with me, follow along. In quantum mechanics, Schrödinger's cat is a thought experiment that illustrates the paradox of quantum superposition. Now, what that means is, in a thought experiment, a hypothetical cat may be alive or dead at the same time when its fate is linked to a subatomic random event that may or may not occur. This thought experiment was devised by Erwin Schrödinger in 1935 in a discussion with Albert Einstein. This scenario is often mentioned in theoretical discussions of the interpretation of quantum mechanics, particularly in situations involving the measurement problem. I've left links to all of the keywords in the sentences I just spoke right now in the description down below, so you can do your study, see all the source material, and understand why I found this so interesting. Point number four, a progressive style. This book is written in a style where the main protagonist gets better and better and better and earns new qualities with every progressing storyline or move he makes in the lore. In books, it is a very, very common style of writing where you present the main protagonist getting stronger and better with every mistake he makes in the storyline and as they progress through every single book. The fact that this book uses morals, values, techniques, and moves that affected George's personality at every single step is why I like this book. You can see how a young boy progresses into a smart young man. He gains perfect knowledge of the world, both scientifically, mentally, and physically. He's understood how the world works in all of these three aspects. And the best part is, it's not only limited to the world, he's now scientifically learning how the universe works. Point number five, the scientific explanations of Stephen Hawking. There's no way I could have excluded this from a Reasons Why video where I explain which things I like about the book. There's no way I could have excluded the main motive behind writing this book. It is a simplistic way to make people understand relatively difficult concepts, like take for example quantum mechanics. Like the latest book which I read did include a quantum computer and everything about quantum mechanics and physics. So Stephen Hawking has tried to explain this along with his daughter in the most understandable of ways. The best thing is, even Stephen Hawking's language in this book is not too hard to understand or scientifically appropriate. You can understand it in the most casual way. Even if you have an average vocabulary, it's super easy to understand. Yes, you do need a little bit of knowledge, like what are atoms, what are molecules, but I guess almost everyone who's reading this book will know stuff like that. And if you don't, there's always a chance to learn new things. Point number six, a collection of scientists. In one of these four books which I have, many scientists from across the world, our world, the real world, have been told to write their own description of what they see fit to that part of the storyline. So all of these scientists are coming and writing down their expertise in the field of science down onto paper so people can read all of that and understand what's going on in the story. Stephen Hawking himself hasn't done the work in this one particular book. He's collaborated with so many different people who have come together to give a super collection of knowledge to you, along with the wonderful storyline, as I mentioned. Point number seven, the explanations of the Big Bang. One major part of the four books that I've read is the Big Bang. As you can see, there's also a book that says George and the Big Bang. So if you're wondering, yes, it's talking about the Big Bang, the one that is said to have generated our entire universe. So it talks about all of it in extreme detail. If you want a video on that, I have reviewed this book, but I'm still going to give you a brief explanation right now. Right, so take for example this. We have Now, 13.7 billion years after the Big Bang, there are images to show what is being explained, but I'll try to explain it in verbal form. Time 200,000 years ago, modern humans appear. 65 million years ago, the age of the dinosaurs comes to an end. So, they're basically gone. Time 175 million years ago, Pangaea, all of Earth's continents united in one big landmass, breaks apart. About 200 million years ago, dinosaurs begin to roam our planets. Roughly 2 billion years ago, oxygen from photosynthesis begins to collect in the Earth's atmosphere. About 3.5 billion years ago, life on Earth begins. Then we have the early Earth is a dangerous place with asteroids hitting it. And then we have as the early solar systems form, our sun is born 4.6 billion years ago. A beautiful spiral galaxy, the Milky Way. Time 13.2 billion years ago, around 500 million years after the Big Bang. Patches of gas collapse into blobs which heat up so much they release nuclear energy to become the first stars. So I'm just going to fast forward towards the end, which says, or maybe reverse back into the end, which says 13.7 billion years ago, 3 minutes after the Big Bang. Hot fog fills the universe as the first nuclei form. 1 microsecond after the Big Bang, the quark gluon plasma has cooled, allowing protons and neutrons to form. Matter and antimatter annihilate, releasing photons, particles of light, which can't travel far through the fog-like plasma. Now time 1 millionth of a microsecond after the Big Bang. All particles have acquired mass with help from the Higgs field. Time 10 billionths of a billionth of a billionth of a microsecond after the Big Bang. The universe has just stopped inflating and released a large amount of energy. The universe is filled with a quark gluon plasma. The inflationary epoch, almost at the Big Bang. The universe is shrinking very fast as we approach the Big Bang. Time, the Planck epoch, new physics, the realm of exotic matter and M theory, still shrinking but not quite so fast. Then we have time, the Big Bang, which says this is when time and space as we understand it should begin. But the universe is still here, incredibly small and still shrinking. Perhaps it will never reach a singularity after all. Do you understand any of that? The characters that come and go. Every single book has a character that comes and goes. So in a couple of books they have some cousins, a couple of books they have some friends, some enemies, some villains. Everyone keeps evolving and changing in this book. So it's really interesting. Point number 9. It is not stretched across 10, 15, 20 books or condensed down into a trilogy or a duology. I feel 6 books is a perfect number for a series. Because if you're trying to read a series, I personally prefer it to be a little longer than a trilogy or a duology. I prefer it to be a little bit longer so that I can have fun reading it over time. Not like I sit down, finish a book in a day, get the next book, finish it in another day, get the next book, finish it in another day. That's just not interesting for me at all. So personally, I like long series and I feel 6 is a really, really appropriate number because it is 2 trilogies, one after each other, so you can just have fun. Personally, my opinion. Point number 10, and it concerns all of you viewers out there. Easy to read, easy vocabulary, good number of pages for a novel, and easy to understand for every single child, adult or child. So that's just my final opinion for this book, because it is super easy to understand, and rightly so, because it is supposed to be super easy to understand. That's the whole point of writing this book. So if you have just a basic knowledge, and like I read, you might get scared after hearing all of that. But if you read the previous parts of this book, you understand what they are talking about, what all of that means. So it's a really, really fun way to educate people. With that, I end my video on 10 reasons why I like Jaws: Secret Key to the Universe. If I convinced you to buy this book, make sure you go ahead and buy it right now. Thank you so much for watching this video. The red subscribe button is waiting for you down. Go smash it. Thank you so much for watching this video. I'm going to see you in the Big Bang. Wait, what?